This can't be. They're not going to do this after a year. Give it a chance, for gosh sake.
It was a sad time for the city of Seattle. It shouldn't have happened.
I couldn't believe it. We'd worked so hard to get Major League Baseball in Seattle.
I was devastated when I found out the team was leaving.
Of course they won't leave. You know, they'll stay forever. This is the Pilots. I love them.
Now the lineup for the hometown Seattle Pilots. At third base and leading off in the order, Tommy Harper. Harper at third. At second base and batting number two will be John Donaldson. Donaldson at second base. Batting third and playing in right field, Wayne Comer. Comer in right. Batting fourth and in center field, Steve Hobley. Hobley in center field. Batting fifth and in left field, Danny Walton. Walton in left. At first base, Don Mincher. Mincher at first base. The catcher will be Jerry McNerney. McNerney behind the plate. The starting shortstop, Fred Stanley.
Go, go, you Pilots, you proud Seattle team. Go, go, you Pilots, go out and build a dream. You brought the majors to the evergreen Northwest. Now go, go, you Pilots, you're going to be the best.
It was a big deal, 1969 in Seattle, to have a second major pro sports team. The Sonics came in 1967. It was a real landmark event to land Major League Baseball. And this would be 7 years after the Seattle World's Fair in 1962 that I think probably put Seattle on the map nationally for things other than sports. And then to have two pro sports franchises arrive in the same decade, well, it was heady times.
I was really excited. I thought that it would be an amazing thing. I just couldn't believe that little Seattle, tucked over in the corner of the country, was getting a major league team.
Thousands and thousands of people were downtown Seattle because Seattle now in the major leagues of baseball. And they were so overjoyed that this finally was going to take place. And they embraced the Pilot team. It was terrific.
That Seattle gave us when we flew up from Tempe to Seattle, and the parade and all the welcoming in the city was tremendous. I mean, a lot of people that don't know Seattle or never really was introduced to Seattle at that time thought that it was just a small little town up in the Northwest someplace, and you know, kind of hicky, and they didn't realize it was a big metropolis with a lot of baseball fans.
I remember being dazzled because it was Major League Baseball and it was colorful and everyone was excited and there just seemed to be such a buzz about the event and the team. I really can't remember much about the game. It was just being there and being part of this scene and only upon reflection did I understand the tenuousness and the temporariness of what was transpiring in front of me, but to a young teenager, it looked like a lot of fun.
Baseball in Seattle started in the 1870s, 1880s, about 20 years after Seattle was settled. And at the time, it was amateur and town team ball. And this eventually morphed into the first professional league in 1890. Seattle was a franchise in a four-team league with Portland, Tacoma, and Spokane. It's called the Pacific Northwest League. And it lasted until mid-season 1892. And then in 1898, Daniel E. Dugdale arrived in Seattle. He was a former big league catcher on his way to the Klondike Gold Rush. And he stopped in Seattle, and he decided to stay, fortunately for us and for our baseball lore. And he attempted a professional league in that first year in 1898. didn't quite take, but by 1901 he was ready to try again, and he started the Pacific Northwest League, and this was the first of 69 consecutive years of professional baseball in Seattle. In 1919, actually before the 1919 season, he sold his ownership interest. He'd had enough. Other business interests were interested in re-entering the Coast League, and this began the era of the Seattle Indians franchise in the Pacific Coast League. By the fall of 1937, they were pretty much near financial ruin. The owners just really couldn't sustain it anymore, so much so that by the end of the season, the last game of the season, city and county officials actually raided the ballpark to get the back taxes that were due to them. So into this breach stepped Emil Sick. And Emil Sick was a local businessman, a brewery owner. He built this brand new ballpark in the Rainier Valley at a cost of estimated $350,000, which was a great sum in the heart of the Depression. And it was a beautiful structure, very fan friendly. And he went about building a team from the front office down that was first rate. So this really began a glorious era for Seattle baseball. The Seattle Rainiers went from being an unsuccessful second division team with the Seattle Indians in the mid to late 30s to having fantastic success in a brand new ballpark and three consecutive pennants, which hadn't been done in the Coast League for 20 years. Proof of Seattle being a baseball town is in the numbers. You look at the fact that Seattle led all minor leagues across the country in attendance from the period of 1939 to 1954. And this included many more populous cities, included all of the minor leagues, not just on the West Coast. And so the structure and the franchise that Emil Sick built coming out of the Depression was really impressive and long-lasting, and it built a base of fans here that led directly to what came after.
It's hard to tell who was making those decisions because whoever was making them didn't really know much about sports because they made the mistake of drafting all older players. Their idea was that they were going to draft these old guys and they were going to be matching their best years, which were, way earlier. You know, those days were long gone. But they were going to draft these guys, and they were going to have their best seasons, match their best seasons, and the Pilots were going to be pennant contenders right away. The Kansas City Royals, on the other hand, were pretty smart. They said, listen, it takes a long time to build a ball club. We're going to go with youth. And so they built a young team, and of course, they succeeded, and the Pilots did not succeed.
It was kind of like a Frankenstein monster team, body parts from everywhere. We had some real squirrels on that team, and I was probably one of them. But, you know, it was a fun team. We had some good guys, guys that had been good in the past. Nuts, bolts, just a lot of stuff.
Well, I knew most of the people who were going to become Seattle Pilots. They were major league players from all over, a conglomeration of real great characters. But they were on the downward side.
We had some older guys that, you know, and we had some older guys and some very young guys. But that's what happens when you get in an expansion draft. Nobody in baseball is going to give you any players. And if you get a real good one in an expansion draft, somebody in that organization made a mistake. They're not going to get rid of guys that have still got a lot left. I was living proof at that work because I sucked that whole year, you know. But there were still some guys that could play a little bit, Don Mencher and some of the boys, Rich Rollins. And they were still good enough to play in the big leagues, but obviously you don't get rid of people that that's going to be doing well for you.
We had players that had winning traditions, so I think my feeling was that the organization tried to get some older players. They knew their financial situation, and I think they wanted to try to put together a team that could be competitive. And so we had, you know, some older players, more so I think than the Kansas City team did. They went for the younger players and to build a team. And really, the first half of the year, we competed pretty well. Pretty well.
He had some good ball players. Mencher was an experienced veteran. He had a pretty good year. Tommy Davis had a good year. And Tommy Harper, look at them, the bases that he stole. He was an exciting ball player.
Tommy Harper's on the base pass and he's ready to run. Buck Rogers is the backstop. I know he's got a gun. But Tommy's not worried. He's the leader in speed. I'm not talking about greenies. I'm talking about feet. Talking about feet. That was most in the AL since 1915. When I think of him now, of everything that he's done, he's Tommy Harper on the base pass, ready to run, ready.
Harper. Steve Hovely started in center field. Look at this. Lou Piniella, left field. Hitless that day. Struck out a couple of times. It wasn't long after that. Marvin Milk said, "You're out of here." And he goes to Kansas City.
Oh, God. The Pilots had obtained Lou Piniella. And he was a guy who had kicked around in the minor leagues for years. He used to play for the Portland minor league franchise. And came to spring training in 1969 and was having a very good season. But for some reason, depends on who you believe, Dewey Soriano or Marvin Milks, the general manager, thought that he was a hothead and was going to disrupt the team and decided that they were going to trade him. And of course, he ended up being Rookie of the Year.
He was one of our, I think, early draft picks, and Marvin Milks got down on him in spring training for some reason or other, and Kansas City offered Steve Whitaker to the ball club for Lou, and I think my recollection is that Soriano didn't like it, and I think he damn near nixed it, but he just decided he better let the guy, you know, do his thing. And so Milks traded him to Kansas City for Steve Whitaker. And Whitaker lasted about, 3 weeks, I think. And so it was one of the big baseball blunders of all time, I think.
Lou Piniella, he was there, that's right. I'll never forget what Joe Schultz, our manager, said. He said, "This guy can't hit." And about 2,800 hits later, I guess he could. That's right, we did get rid of Lou. I forgot about him.
One of the problems that the Pilots made is they tried to judge players based on their personalities. If they thought a guy was, had a fiery personality or was difficult or in some way weird or different, they saw that as a defect. So they saw Piniella's hot-temperedness as a defect. They saw Mike Marshall's cerebral attitude toward the game as being a defect. This was weird. Steve Hovely's wonderful spaciness, they saw that as somehow subversive. And my rebellious nature and my giving anti-war talks the year before in Central Park made me somehow communist or a rebel of some kind. And so they got rid of us. They did not see that players who are somehow different, instead of that being a weakness, that's a strength. Because in the environment where most players are conservative from small towns, to be different is to be, you have to be pretty strong to maintain your identity in that environment. But they saw it as a weakness rather than a strength. They should have been looking for guys who were different instead of trying to get rid of them.
Some of the stories that I heard about Lou at Portland, he probably would never have played in the big leagues if it wasn't, or the opportunity. He had the talent, but he probably wouldn't have got the opportunity if it wasn't for the expansion draft.
For some it was their cup of coffee, for most it was their best last chance. There was no such thing as free agency, just cast-offs looking for a raft, unprotected in the expansion draft. So let's hear it, boys, for the Pilots, 'cause this could be our year. Best last chance. For some it was their first and last.
If you were a rookie player and you were playing behind some guy who was a starting shortstop and you were a second string shortstop and sitting on the bench, the fact that you got drafted by a team that was a new team forming, well, that was pretty exciting because now you might get to play sooner. For an old guy sitting on the bench, same thing. Hey, this could be a resurrection of my career. Maybe I could find my swing, my old curveball, whatever it is. This was an opportunity. But of course, the old guys understood too. Boy, when you get put on a list to be drafted, your best years are pretty much behind you. But athletes don't think that way. They think, okay, you know, I can still win. I haven't been given an opportunity here. I'm going to go to the Seattle Pilots. I'm going to make the team. And I'm going to be back where I was before. So everybody has high hopes about being drafted by a new team.
A lot of us would have been banished or maybe going back to AAA baseball. So we were given the new, you can pick, except for the Minchners and the Rollins, the Tommy Harpers, but the fill-ins that you look at, Mike Hegan, Comer, Tommy Davis still would have been, he would have been one of the guys that would have stayed with the big club. But if you really look at the Minerknees and all the rest of us, we could have easily been sent back and never be heard from again, AAA baseball. So I think it was a great opportunity, yeah. We had nothing to lose. Everybody there was given a free pass to, or a pass to play one more year, possibly, maybe more, if their career was revitalized.
See, these guys knew that this was their last chance. They were, for the most part, the older people. And they had a chance to get at least one more year in the major leagues, and they were happy to be there. They did so much work in the community in Seattle, had no problems. They loved Joe Schultz. They loved the coaching staff. Sure, they wanted to win more than they did, but they knew what the situation was.
They were a colorful bunch. Good guys, most all of them. They played hard. I mean, they didn't decide, well, let's just wait out the season or something. They played hard, and they had a lot of pride. And they knew they were tail end Charlies, but they were going to give it the best shot they could.
We call ourselves a bunch of mutants, man. We're all cast-offs and just hoping to revitalize our careers. And we didn't really realize how much of a cast-off we were until we got into seeing Six Stadium and all that stuff once we went up north. But I knew about Six Stadium because I grew up here.
Well, this was the whole issue in getting a franchise for the previous 7 or 8 years, and the reason that it was never taken completely seriously is anybody that came here, whether it was Joe Cronin or his representatives from the American League, just about anybody with any degree of authority that looked at Sick Stadium from the early to mid-60s forward, the first thing they said is, well, this is not a home for Major League Baseball. Possibly an interim home with substantial upgrades, but as it stands now, there's absolutely no possible way.
I grew up in Tacoma, where Cheney Stadium, the AAA stadium, was my notion of professional baseball. And that was a very delightful 8,000-seat stadium. So Sick Stadium seemed to be this magnificent edifice. I had no other perspective upon which to judge Major League Stadium. So this thing seemed to be huge and soaring and epic and just wonderful. I was wrong.
Well, Sick Stadium was clearly, an upgraded minor league ballpark. Probably wasn't even the best of the minor league ballparks, the AAA teams. But it was decent enough. We remember, of course, they were still building the damn thing, even on opening day. People were lined up outside, and when they would nail down a section of wood in the bleachers, they'd let in another 20 people.
I remember coming into the stadium and seeing trucks and construction things going on, because as I learned later, they were basically painting the stadium and getting the last touches on it just as the opening day arrived.
He was really upset at that the city had agreed to, I can't remember now, do some remodeling on the ballpark and add seats and all these things that were not done in time, and the bathrooms weren't working well, and a lot of that really got to him. Now, I'm surely was not the whole problem at all, but those were problems I was aware of because I'd do the little inspections with him. You know, we'd walk around the park and he'd check on all these things.
But it was a thrown together facility, and we had a lot of problems. We couldn't flush the toilets in the press box until the seventh inning because the water pressure was down. And we had one instance where a fan sitting out in the portable bleachers out in right field got locked in a Santa can. And he didn't get out of there until the morning when they came to clean the places. He was pounding on it, but there was nobody there to hear of it.
I think, as far as I can recall, the field was okay. It was just a small ballpark, you know. It wasn't the standards that we were used to, like the Yankee Stadiums and other big ballparks. Baltimore was a big ballpark that I came out of. I don't think there was a park that small in the big leagues at that time.
Sick Stadium was not too welcoming in the clubhouse. I mean, I just was in the clubhouse yesterday at Safeco. I mean, come on, 5-star hotel. We were in a seedy hotel. That was our Our clubhouse was, it's hard to describe. It was small, it was old wood. It was like being in, you ever see Bull Durham? The movie Bull Durham, that was it. That was our clubhouse.
But the clubhouses were old, and the whole stadium was old. If they'd have had a new stadium here to start with, I don't think the Pilots would have ever left. But I don't think they had a whole lot of time to put this team together and the organization together. You know, it was boom, 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 and you can't build a stadium overnight.
They could seat maybe, for AAA ball, around 10,000, but that wasn't enough for the major leagues. They got it up close to 25,000, but they weren't the greatest seats in the world.
So I thought it was almost, because it was a minor league ballpark, almost felt like the fans were closer to you, and you know, more so than some of the big ballparks that you're in today.
When I was a kid and you watch old Hollywood movies and baseball, they weren't these luxurious ballyards. They were ballyards like six, with nothing better than the advertisement on the walls. And they're all different. You know, there isn't a ballpark like Sick Stadium. There's not a ballpark like Wrigley Field. Not a ballpark like Boston. And I loved it. So lighting could have been better. But I loved it. Of course, I did very well there. So
I can remember standing, I think, somewhere in the stadium and looking out and seeing Mount Rainier, which was pretty awesome for a Flatlander, Iowa kid, saying, wow, this is some place to live. Snow-capped peaks within sight of a downtown Major League stadium.
On the road trip that I got to go on to Anaheim, Oakland, and Kansas City, their stadiums at that time really weren't much better, if any. In fact, Kansas City's was probably worse. So to me, this, even though people complained about the stadium, I thought it was great. It was a great venue.
No, it's got the short porch because I could hit them out there fairly easy.
And of course, what I liked about it had the short porch in left field. You know, for a right-handed hitter, it was great.
That wasn't exactly a pitcher's ballpark. You know, you could take a leak over the left field fence from home plate.
I mean, it was a terrible facility, but we made do with it, you know. I often wondered if we'd had a facility like the Mariners have now, that the Pilots would still be here, but.
Had been around baseball for a long, long time, an old catcher with the St. Louis Browns, coaching with a number of Major League Baseball teams, and then had a good reputation of being a good guy, a player's manager. And they liked Joe. They would tease him. Joe would probably make some wrong decisions during a game, but they didn't care. They just loved the guy.
I didn't think he was a good manager at all, but I liked him as a person, and I loved him as a writer because he was a magnificent character, and part of his magnificence was that he didn't belong in that role, and he had sort of a coach's mentality and demeanor. A coach's job is to sort of, be a jolly guy, keep everybody pepped up, you know, be a sort of a funny guy. That's sort of sidekick to the coach, sidekick to the manager, drinking buddy of the guy who's really running the team. Most teams are run by, you know, fierce guys or stern guys or business-like guys. Joe Schultz wasn't any of those. He wasn't business-like, he wasn't stern, and he wasn't fierce. He was a jolly guy, always saying funny things. And so he became extremely quotable.
I remember one time we lost about, we lost about 14 out of 12 games. And Joe walks in and he says, "All right, men, up and at 'em, fuck 'em all, let it all hang out." This was really good advice, you know.
We're getting our butt kicked by Kansas City, and I figure his job's on the line. He's going to be tight and mad, and he takes off his glass and wipes it down and goes, "Goose, have you ever got laid in this town?"
We're in the ninth inning. I don't remember the score. I think we might have had a two-run lead. Bases are loaded, and Willie Horton's at the plate. Two outs, and Gellner's knees are knocking out then. I walk to the mound, and Joe Schultz comes out, and I think, well, here we go. Joe's going to give us something to get out of this jam. And he kind of looked Gellner in the eye. He said, "Shit, meat, get this guy out so we can go get a cold Budweiser," and turned around and walked off the mound.
And I thought Joe did a good job of keeping the players relaxed. He always talked about it. He always said, you know, that when the game was over, have a bud and relax, and that was his kind of saying. But you know, I just enjoyed him that he tried to keep the team. You know, he didn't try to put a lot of pressure. Go out there and play your best. If you made a mistake doing something, or they'd talk it over and, you know, explain to you what you should have done. And so I enjoyed Joe. He for me, it was a fun experience.
Joe Schultz was probably one of the best managers I've had without having to know much baseball. Joe was very good at having people pull in the right direction together and like each other and get along. As a tactical manager, he was horrible. But he had Ron Plaza sitting alongside him, and he'd just lean over and say, "What do I do now?" And that was fine, and we knew it, and that's okay. So he got the how-tos from other people, and that's what coaches are for. So,
if he'd have been a better manager, we wouldn't have risen that far in the standings anyway. We just didn't have the ability. That was another thing about Joe. He felt sorry for us. You know, he told us we just didn't have the talent. A couple of times, he would actually say something to that effect.
To me, Joe Schultz, who managed Seattle, was the smartest manager I ever met in my life. You know why? He played me. It's the truth. I deemed him a genius.
I don't know if people knew this, but he worked for years at St. Louis as a St. Louis Cardinals coach. And of course, one of the things we found out is he owned a lot of Anheuser-Busch stock. So after the game, the coolers were full of Anheuser-Busch beer. So we win or lose, he'd come in, "Hey, nice going, guys. Great, nice try if we lost. We'll get them tomorrow. Pound that Budweiser into you."
I remember a couple meetings, you know, you have a meeting before the game and you go over to hitters and the pitcher said, "Well, I want to do this, want to do that." And Joe says, "Okay, let's just go get them. High and tight, low and away, and let's go pound the Bud afterwards." He gimped, you know, he had that bad leg. And, "Men, pound that Budweiser tonight. Pound that Budweiser." You know, the win or lose or draw, he didn't care, you know.
"Hey, boys, pound that old Budweiser." This is before the game, you know.
Somebody order a Bud, and he said, "We want to pound some Bud tonight."
Might as well forget that final score. This game is over, can't do it anymore. Just listen to the wisdom of our great advisor when it tells you that the time is right. Pound that Budweiser, pound that Bud, pound that Budweiser, pound that Bud. Pound that Bud. Joe Schultz must have been a marvelous man. Does he always stuck to a very simple plan? Pound that Budweiser, pound that Bud, pound that Budweiser, pound that Bud.
The season got off to a good start. In fact, the manager, Joe Schultz, had predicted that the Pilots were going to finish third in the division. They managed to stick around in the upper part of the division for the early part of the season, but about midway through the season, injuries started hitting. And they didn't have anybody to replace those frontline guys, and pretty soon they just went into a tailspin.
Well, I got caught up with it just like everybody else. We had a decent spring, and players live in fairyland. Fairyland is, hey, this is where we could be. We could really win this thing. When Gary Bell won on opening day, and we won 8-0, I thought, hey, this ball club could go places. And so I was just as enthusiastic as anybody else.
Well, we were doing pretty good the first month and a half of the season. We were holding our own as a club, playing good baseball, or you know, better baseball than we probably. They probably expected, and then we started hitting a lot of the Eastern clubs, the Baltimore and the Yankees and stuff like that, and started getting beat up a little bit. But
had a great start, and we're up in the standings, and then all of a sudden the bottom dropped out. Trades, they traded Tommy Davis, They traded Jim Bouton. They traded a number of other people. Didn't win too many games in July and August, but had a great time.
We at least put on a good front for a while, and if we had held together at the end, I think we could have surprised a lot of people. I think we folded toward the tail end a little bit.
We didn't all suddenly, you know, start playing badly. We just started playing to our recent recent performances, which is what put us on the benches of all those teams.
No one likes to lose. I mean, people hate losing. And so, you know, to keep their jobs, I mean, they wanted to win. They wanted to, you know, do well. I mean, everybody does.
Even though they collectively know that they're not going to make a challenge for first place, you know, they really want to be respectable, and it's a matter of pride. And in that, there was a great spirit. So in that, you joined, you know, the Gene Brabenders of the world and Tommy Harpers of the world, and we had a great time doing the very best we could with what we had.
The national mood was really a sense of crisis. 1968 had been a particularly traumatic year in the United States, and when you look at what historians have said about the late 60s, their books are titled things like Fire in the Streets and The Unraveling of America and Years of Discord. So there's a real sense that the nation might be coming apart. 1968 saw two major political assassinations with Martin Luther King Jr. and Robert Kennedy. You see the fifth or sixth year of major rioting during the summer of 1968 after Martin Luther King Jr.'s assassination. That's the year of the Tet Offensive when, you know, Walter Cronkite goes on television, the most trusted man in America, and says the government's been lying, essentially. We are in a stalemate in Vietnam. Major protests on campuses and in cities across the country. And so really a sense that either a revolution's coming or there's a severe polarization in the United States at that time.
One of the things I thought was very funny about a ball team is that they were completely isolated from the rest of the world. They were like a pod, a little pod that traveled around as a unit. We got on the bus together, we got on a plane together, went to the restaurants together, went to the ballpark together. We went to the bar afterwards, the bars after. So it was like, and the rest of the world was an annoyance.
Now, I think we were aware that the world was changing, and not all for the better, but not all for the worst either. But I can't really recall that that had much effect on the Seattle Pilots or how well we played or how poorly we played.
Well, I knew what was going on. You know, you can't live in this world with all the things that were taking place at that time with the Panther Party and you know, all the demonstrations. You had to be aware of it. I was aware of it, you know, and it touched me in a lot of ways, not physically, but mentally it did, because it's still one of the best places in the world to live, the United States and America, and I'll fight anybody to tell me that it isn't. And we're not perfect, but we'll get in there. And baseball was just part of me. It was all of me. And that's all I cared about those things, but I wanted to go play ball.
Those years, as volatile as they were, you know, and I was having to be with the Oakland A's when Martin Luther King was shot and assassinated. What a horrible thing. We were in Baltimore right after it happened. The armed guard come in, BARs loaded on the street corners, and, you know, you go, what in the world's going on? You know, and you stand there, or at least I think, the people I was around, the athletes were just mostly shocked, in awe, and somewhat saying, what is wrong with us as a society to have this happen?
We would drive through Oakland, for example, on our way to the ballpark. I go through San Francisco, or Haight-Ashbury or something, we'd go through a neighborhood where we'd be, there'd be street demonstrations, and the kids would be out there in the streets with their beards and their sandals and marching against the war, and you could smell the marijuana haze and stuff. And so the guys would roll down the windows and holler at these kids, you know, hey, how about taking some more drugs, or why don't you people go take a bath? And this is from players, by the way, who were all taking amphetamines and sleeping pills and all sorts of drugs of their own, you know, and hollering these kids for taking drugs. It was very interesting.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
The man on the moon. There's another memorable moment. And that was a Sunday at 6 Seattle Stadium. The PA system that day was hooked up to the broadcast. The game stopped. We all heard they've landed. Stillness. You could hear a pin drop out there on that Sunday afternoon. Big crowd. They were all tuned to the PA system. It was quite a day, no doubt about it.
And the moon landing, well, that was interesting. It was interesting for a few minutes in a bullpen, a conversation. What about the moon landing? Well, forget the scientific achievement of it all or the historic nature of it. Seattle pilots' view of the moon landing was summed up very, very well, I thought, when one of the players said that that's a long time to go without sex. The least they should have done was to supply some germ-free broads for these guys. That's the moon landing.
When it came to baseball, I didn't think of anything else, but I was one of those guys that politics, you know, all of this stuff is, like right now, all I do is read the sports page. I don't care to hear about all the politics and everything.
These guys were a very conservative group. And so they weren't sympathetic to the war and the protests. One of the players, Steve Hovley, had come from Stanford. His hair was maybe an inch too long at that time. So his hair wasn't at all lengthy. But I know Joel Schultz was not going to have anyone on the field with long hair at all. And the players teased him and gave him a hard time, I think, for a couple of reasons. One is he had a college education from Stanford. They were just hardworking Joes. And so they were merciless to him.
Oh, the war was occasionally there'd be a discussion of the war in the bullpen. But it was immediately squelched. Guys didn't want to talk about the war. They wanted to talk about hunting. Not people, they wanted to talk about hunting animals and guns. So hunting and guns was big. Talking about the war that was really affecting everybody's life. No, forget that. Let's talk about hunting. So these were the topics of conversation. And if you wanted to talk about politics or what was happening in the country or what was happening in the world, then you know, you were uninvited to the party.
Very apparent by mid-season that the local ownership and that the operation of the franchise was not going to be in the black and that they were going to have major problems. The attendance was disappointing. All of the retrofitting for the ballpark that was supposed to be done by the time the season opened, it wasn't even done by the time the season ended. And of course, they started off pretty well in the season, but then, as you'd expect with the team of scraggly veterans, their injuries hit and the team, like most expansion teams, started to not play so well as the season progressed, so they started to lose. Nobody wants to go see a ball team that's not winning. They lost 98 games, almost 100 games. You combine that with the highest ticket prices in the major leagues and pepper in the fact that the local ownership was publicly squabbling with city officials about the improvements that weren't made. That may have backfired on them, as the people are reading this in the newspaper and saying, well, why do I want to pay these high ticket prices to go to this ballpark with these uncomfortable seats and not great conditions? And maybe I'll do something else.
The now Commissioner of Baseball, Bud Selig, had an empty stadium in Milwaukee because Bud, who was the principal owner of the Milwaukee Braves, lost his Braves to Atlanta. So County Stadium was just sitting there, a major league ballpark.
When Selig read in the newspaper that the Pilots were having trouble and might relocate, he contacted Dewey Soriano about possibly buying the team and moving it to Milwaukee. Selig and Soriano reached a secret agreement to sell the team and move it to Milwaukee. When this came out, Major League Baseball said, it's no big deal. It's an agreement. We have no intention of moving the team. We're working hard to keep it here. They advanced the team a small amount of money. It was something like $450,000 to get them through the rest of the season, and they said they would try to help find a buyer in Seattle who would keep the team here. Well, there were problems with that because there was no Major League ready stadium. The Pilots had not done well in their first year, and it was during a time of bust in Seattle. There was signs, billboards up around town saying, you know, will the last person who leaves Seattle turn out the lights?
I don't think anybody was making any plans to buy a home up there, let's put it that way. Because at that time, Boeing's was going to shits too. Boeing's was, for many sakes, those Boeing executives that had these, at that time, $500,000 homes, they were trying to dump them for $100,000, $200,000. You know, I mean, the whole area was just kind of like in a flux at that time. And it was a tough time for the whole economy.
These people couldn't withstand those financial losses they were faced with, and nobody had stepped forward to take over the team.
I think it was the end of July, if I remember, that they were having financial problems, and there was a little rumbling going on, and are we going to get paid? And we did, but I know as the season grew older, they were quite concerned about getting paid. And
whether you like it or not, you're in tune to what's going on, and you hear certain things. And it was always an issue of funding. It was always a minute, are they well capitalized? And it seemed to be an issue.
Most of the money was borrowed. The big financier was Bill Daley, who was a former owner of the Cleveland Indians. And he had a lot of money, but he didn't really want to spend it. And when people didn't flock to the ballpark the way that it was anticipated that they were going to, Daley decided he didn't want to put any more money into it. Early on in the season, somewhere about June or July, they knew that there were going to be problems, because the attendance figures and the finances were just not matching up to their projections, and they knew that they were going to have to get some more money to get through the season. That was not coming through attendance, there was no TV contract, and so the money had to come from somewhere.
They would have played there again the following year because Bill Daley had said in a press conference that he says, owe it to Seattle to give him one more year. And so one of the writers, who is now deceased, on the Times wrote a big column blasting Daley for saying, we should give you one more year or something. And he just was terrible. It was the worst possible thing that could have happened. And I think Daley just threw up his hands and said, well, I guess they don't want it after all. And
when they were trying to save the team, this gentleman, I believe his name was Warren Campbell, who was the president of the Bank of California, had said that the bank was not going to participate in loaning money to any would-be buyers of the team. They had financed, I think, about $4.5 million of the team's original funding and said, we are not going to be a part of this. It was very difficult to try to find somebody who was going to keep the team in Seattle. While at the same time, there was sort of the path of least resistance going on in Milwaukee to move the team.
The City Fathers tried to save that franchise. They did everything they could. But one day in Chicago, all the American League baseball owners from Gene Autry right on down the line, met in Chicago, and they decided to take that franchise away from Seattle and move it to Milwaukee. Had they waited maybe two more months, the King Dome would have been on the drawing board at the time, and that franchise would have stayed.
When I think of the Pilots, I think of the clubhouse. A small, cramped clubhouse. I think of a rainy day when everybody's sort of trapped in there. We don't know whether we're going to play, we're not going to play. Guys are sitting around and, you know, uniforms half on, half off, baseball underwear, no underwear, uniforms, shirts, just a motley collection of guys who don't look like they're ready to play any sport at all. Sitting around, playing cards, kibitzing, ragging on each other. It's late in the season, but we know we're not going anywhere at all.
Gene Brabender, for example, brought a blowgun into the clubhouse. It was a homemade blowgun. Nobody could afford to buy a real blowgun. He comes in with about an 8-foot length of pipe. You guys remember this? An 8-foot length of pipe. And what he's done is he's taken these a coat hanger and cut them up into four-inch darts. And the front of the coat hanger has been filed a really sharp point, like a nail. And the back of the, I hate to sort of give you instructions on how to do this, but the back of the coat hanger had a little like a cone, ice cream cone, so that it filled up the pipe. And I don't know where Bender learned how to do this, but probably some tribe in Black Rock, Wisconsin, or something. Anyway, and when a player would come into the clubhouse, he would shoot this dart, and he would drive it into the molding about 2 inches into the molding. You know, a couple of feet above guys' heads. You know, boom.
You come in the clubhouse, and these freaking missiles are flying around. You could have been killed in there. You know. I used to worry about a line drive killing me, but not a poison dart in the neck, you know. I'll never forget that. Oh, man.
There was a huge fan club for Ray Oyler, who was a shortstop, and I'm surprised he kept his job as long as he did, because he was hitting in the mid-100s. And one of the things he had was a corked bat, which was totally, totally illegal. But he was probably so desperate to keep his job that he would do anything to do so. And so I was instructed, if that bat ever broke, that I was to get all the parts, get it to the clubhouse as quickly as possible, and no one was ever going to see that bat.
I remember a really hot, sweaty, you know, dirty game. And we came in after the game, and there was no water. There was no water. We were sitting around. When is it going to happen? Half an hour went by. They're still trying to work on it. They're still trying to get the water in there. So anyway, I take my uniform. Steve Barber left the whirlpool for a few minutes, and I so I took my uniform off, and I got into the whirlpool with a bar of soap. And the players were going, look at Boughton, for Christ's sake. It's disgusting. Taking a bath. Remember that? Taking a bath in the whirlpool. Anyway, I get all sedged up and I get rinsed off and I get out of the whirlpool and I go over to my locker and I'm starting to get dressed. And as I'm dressing and finally I, you know, get my hair. And just as I'm buttoning my shirt to walk out of the clubhouse, I look over and I see a line forming at the whirlpool.
And then I remember when Goosen joined the ball club, I think Greg was a first baseman originally, but Minchard was over there, so he wasn't going to play any first base, and they put him in left field, and that was kind of an adventure. I was telling Greg last night, I said, I remember it was twilight, and high fly ball left field, and of course shortstop goes out after it, and I'm keep going, and I don't hear anything from Greg, so I keep going, and I'm out there by the bullpen somewhere, and I finally made the catch. And Greg's standing on left field like this. He never did see anything. So he says, well, thank God you kept an eye on it, kid.
So I'm in Seattle and in a bar talking to this young woman. I mean, just talking, no big thing. I felt sort of full of myself that I was in the big leagues again. And this is after I was called up from Milwaukee, from Vancouver. And she goes, what do you do for a living? I go, well, I'm with the Pilots. She goes, really? That's interesting. What airlines? And I said, no, the Seattle Pilots, the baseball club. And she had this blank stare on her face. And I just said, TWA. And she went, oh, that's good.
You know, merit renew. Going to a lawyer, take the trouble to go to a lawyer and have a paternity suit drafted against Fred. Now, Fred, I'm sure, was innocent, but who wants to win a paternity suit, you know? So everybody in the clubhouse knows that this is a fake thing, and, you know, but they're all watching Fred. And it's so intimate, of course. You look over there and, you know, somebody hands this thing to Fred. He opens it up, he reads it, puts it up in the top of his locker, lights up a cigarette. Everybody's looking at him, you know. Puts the cigarette back in, reaches back up there, and he's reading it again. It really is that, you know, wow, oh man. Puts it back, he finally gets up, and he walks out of the clubhouse, and we don't know where he's going, but as soon as he leaves the clubhouse, you know, Tommy Davis said, you know, I didn't think you white guys could get any whiter.
When the Yankees came to town, that famous fight in baseball at second base, our shortstop Ray Euler and Thurman Munson running from first to second, sliding into second base. Euler, Munson, tangle, start a fight, benches empty. Ball players all over the field. It was great.
I had a reputation for staying out and once in a while drinking too much. And my guy I stayed at the Ramada Inn with was a guy named George Burnett. And George was an old-time ball player, you know, left-handed, gritty guy. And at the end of the year, not at the end, but a couple months before, Dewey Soriano, the owner of the Pilots, throws a party, you know, out of the blue. So we're going to a party. I'm getting dressed, and George, he comes over to my place and goes, now, Goose, you're doing well right now, and you gotta be careful when you go in there. You know, we're going to go in there, and we're going to have a couple drinks, say hello, Mr. Soriano, Mr. Milks, hello, and leave. You know, just, I'm doing this to protect you. You understand, Greg? I say, sure, okay. He's an older guy, and you respected older guys. So we take George's car, and we drive to the party, and we're having a couple drinks, and I look over, and here comes George with Marvin Milks in a headlock. He goes, now Goose there is hitting the ball well, ain't he, Marv? And Marvin goes, yeah. He said, well, give him a raise. How's 15,000? I'll think about it, Georgie. Here's a guy, we'll have a couple drinks, so he lets him go. And I go, George, what are you doing? You're killing me. And he goes, oh, don't worry about it. George has had a couple drinks. And he's gone now, so I can tell the story, but all of a sudden there's a knock on the door. And there's this cab driver that goes, who called the cab? There's still a lot of guys in there. And George goes, I did. I said, George, we drove here. He goes, I know. Just take my word for it. And he came with him and he gives the cab driver, I don't know, $30. And he says, drive the Ramada in. I'll follow you. I forget how to get there.
So there's thousands of dollars ready and waiting for lucky fans. Keep on listening. If your name is called during the home run inning, you can collect over $1,000 for a home run or $25,000 for a grand slam homer. The very next home run could have your name written on it.
Well, you know, I just happened to hit a home run in the seventh inning one particular game, and I think I won a fan like $5,000, you know, and lo and behold, that fan sent me a check for 10%, sent me a check for $500, which I thought, my gosh, this is unheard of, you know. Well, later on, towards the end of the year, Fred Talbot, pitcher for the Pilots, gets up with bases loaded, hits a grand slam in the seventh inning, and wins this fan $25,000.
Fred starts off down to first base, and before he hit second base, it was decided in the bullpen that Fred should receive a telegram from Donald DuBois thanking him for his prodigious effort and promising him $5,000 as a token of appreciation. So since that was my idea, I had to go to the telegraph office the next day and have a bogus telegram made up. And the genius moment was when I, dear Mr. Talbert, I misspelled his name so that it would seem like a real telegram. Anyway, so this gets put on a stack of mail in front of Fred's locker. And of course, everybody knows it's a, you know, it's phony. And anyway, we play the game. We're now on the bus to the airport because we're heading for a road trip. And Fred's been having a little secret smile all day long, you know, because he's got this telegram. So he's sitting on the back of the bus, Ray Euler sitting next to him, and Fred says, hey, Ray, take a look at this. Ray looks at it. Of course, he knows what it is. And he says, what if it's one of the guys playing a trick? And Fred says, nah, if it was one of the guys, they wouldn't have misspelled my name.
I hit the last home run in Pilots, and I wanted to stick around the clubhouse and enjoy that moment. We didn't know we weren't going to be there, but we knew the season was over, and it was a crazy-ass season, and let's enjoy this, have some beers before everybody disperses. They wanted us out of that clubhouse. They weren't washing anything. They weren't washing towels. They were shoveling it in big carts and taking them on these van lines outside the stadium. Little did we know, these van lines had pulled up during the game. We didn't know what was going on, but they didn't want you. They were trying to hurry us out of there. Get the hell out of this clubhouse and so we can pack all this stuff up. So we're wondering. But 2 weeks before that or 3 weeks before that, there was thing in the paper that we weren't going to get paid. They were having a hard time even making payroll. So now it all started coming together. Van lines are out there. They're shoveling all this stuff. And I'm sure all of us kind of figure, what's going on? Yeah, I go home.
The next year when we went to spring training, there was rumors around, you know, that the club was struggling. And it wasn't until late even in spring training we really knew that we were planning, you know, I had my stuff still in Seattle, you know, from the year before. I was single at the time, and I had left my stuff in Seattle to come back here and was looking forward to it.
So all of us went to Tempe, Arizona again. And before it was official and became the Milwaukee Brewers, we were into spring training games. And Jimmy Dudley and myself had to do the games as the Pilots for a while. Then that day came when it was official. And I believe it was four games, as I recall, we broadcast as the Milwaukee Brewers. Now that was tough to take. And then when spring training was over, we were going to Milwaukee. Jimmy Dudley and I were going back to Seattle with no ball club.
I obviously wasn't very sophisticated in the ways of sports business back then, but it didn't seem to make any sense. I had read stories about the travail, financial travail the team was in, but I didn't, it just seemed in, unconscionable that a major league operation would move a team after a single year. And so I kept in my, you know, mind about being a fan, I kept thinking, this can't be. They're not going to do this after a year. Give it a chance, for gosh sakes.
No, it really wasn't a surprise. We had a terrible feeling that it was going to happen. It was a sad time for the city of Seattle. It shouldn't have happened.
I'll be honest with you, I was crestfallen. I couldn't believe it. Because we'd worked so hard to get Major League Baseball in Seattle.
Well, I feel like it's a kind of a sad thing that happened. You know, there's no reason that team couldn't have stayed here forever, and why not? I wonder, you know, what they were thinking about to put an organization together like that with no money.
I felt sorry for the fans. They were anticipating Major League Baseball for the rest of their lives up there, but it didn't work out. And of course, a few years later, Kingdome was up. They get baseball back again.
But I enjoyed it immensely in Seattle. Broke my heart when they moved.
I do remember that it was weird following the Milwaukee Brewers and seeing those guys' names in the box scores. And I remember seeing pictures of them in those uniforms and going, that's not fair.
If success had been based on my father's enthusiasm, they'd still be here. I mean, he was so enthusiastic about it. And I think Uncle Max was as well. It didn't work out. You know, it didn't work out. But it wasn't a scheme to unload it and make money on it. I mean, that he would much rather have them here. Much rather.
I was devastated when I found out the team was leaving because I never got a chance to go to a game with my dad. It was one of those, we'll do it next year type things, and there was no next year.
We were so much younger. It always seemed to be summer. And one more game to play. But somewhere the truth caught up. The truth is we were brought up to be sent back down to stay. And the fields that we roam are decayed and overgrown. Oh, glitz Friday days, deep drives and perfect planes thrown out at home.
Just a marvelous collection of guys. Fred Talbot, you know, Ray Euler, Don Mincher, these guys were just fantastic. And because they were from all different teams, they were playing together for the first time, and so they were getting to know each other. So they were all telling each other their stories. So as a writer, I was able to get all the great stories from the Minnesota Twins, from Don Mincher, the Boston Red Sox stories from Gary Bell, the Detroit Tigers stories from Ray Oil of the Kansas City Stories from John O'Donohue. It was as if somebody put this team together and said, well, they're not going to win many ball games, but if somebody writes a book, this is a hell of a ball club.
I always saw Jim with this notebook in his left hip pocket all the time. So we're talking, I said, Jim, I said, you're always taking notes. I said, don't tell me you're going to write a book. And he says, Sean, as a matter of fact, I am.
Every time something funny would happen at bullpen, he'd pull out a spiral notebook and write it down. He said, oh, that's hilarious. I said, well, why are you writing it down unless you're writing? But he said, oh, I just want to make sure I remember it. I said, nah, you would remember it.
I had no idea what he was doing. I knew he took a lot of notes in the clubhouse.
He captured the sheer immature funniness that draws you to the game. I mean, grown-ups don't do that stuff. You know, grown-ups don't do what he mentioned in the book. Because one thing, there's an old saying, you have to grow old, but you can stay immature all your life. And we did, it was just maybe a way to relieve pressure, but it was that greatest thing about baseball, you could be 30, 40, and act like a 16-year-old. I don't know if that's what people dream to do, but it was something we did.
And I found it just an absolutely hilarious and wonderful look at the inside of baseball. And of course, it caused a huge controversy because it was not treating baseball with the reverence that it had become accustomed to in both literature and in daily journalism. And Jim Boughton's book, I think, changed a lot of things about baseball and the way the media covers it. And so from a standpoint now as a professional, I think it was a landmark event.
Ball 4 was such a seminal work, not just in terms of sports literature, but just literature in general. And, you know, really the first sports book to humanize and demythologize the professional athlete and give, you know, the reader a look behind the scenes and see what their daily life was like. It was revolutionary at the time. It seems a little more benign now when you read it. But at the time, which not coincidentally was a time of, you know, real social upheaval in the country, to have this, it really opened a lot of people's eyes. And of course, all of this would be meaningless if not for the fact that it was extraordinarily funny and just a wonderful read.
I thought, from a very academic standpoint, I thought Jim was extremely accurate. I think he was extremely personally emotional about his feelings towards the people he was talking about, the Mickey Mantles of the world, and his issues, because Jim was a very savvy individual politically and business-wise.
I enjoyed it. You know, I was there for most of the things that he wrote about, and I didn't think they were so bad. There were some wives that I didn't care for it upon occasion.
It was the 60s. It was irreverent. It was exposing stuff that wasn't talked about before. But nonetheless, it was real. And I think to try and hide the realities is not all that good either. So Jim got a lot of flack and a lot of heat, but in reality, probably the people that got in trouble were the ones that earned the heat.
He's injected a lot of things in there that were, and inflamed some things that weren't really all that significant, but, you know, to make it fly, you got to do that, and I don't blame him for writing the book. What the heck, he's a nice gentleman, I think, and a nice guy, but a lot of the players don't think very highly of him anymore, but he was never a problem to me. The only problem he presented to me was, as I may have mentioned, is that used to hang around my office a lot because I think he had his eye on my secretary.
I know when I went up, he didn't think I should have went up, but the book really, I think that's what really made the Seattle Pilots well known is the book, and you know, he did do a good job. I know there's some guys that didn't appreciate it, but yeah, you know, that's life and stuff, so.
When the book did come out, and we were both back in AAA at that time, he was on camera, and I just proceeded to tell him what he could do with each page of the book. And that's not because of me. As far as Dooley Womack was concerned, I didn't really care. I didn't like the idea of cutting Mantle and Ford down. I'm one of these, well, I'm a Mickey Mantle fan, admire him, still do, regardless of what he did on the field or off the field.
Many more of the goings-on on a Major League Baseball team that do influence game outcomes and seasonal outcomes are reported much more aggressively than it used to be before ball four. And certainly the background that Boughton talked about with the players' habits and wanderings at night, it's all now sort of an accepted understanding by most fans, and the breakthrough event was ball four.
Years ago, there was a major league team here, a major league team that lasted 1 year, the Seattle Pilots. There's a reunion here. There is Jim Boughton, the knuckleballer, throwing out the first pitch here on this beautiful evening. Nice to have the 69 Pilots here.
Even if you weren't born then, even if you've moved to Seattle only recently, the story of this thing is still fascinating, and it's still, I think, from those people who have been here, who have those memories, there's a certain affection for that period in Seattle sports history. So I think it would be embraced even if you weren't alive or around or aware of the Pilots at the time. I think this part of Seattle's history is worth revisiting.
I get probably 3 to 4 requests for autographs a month by pitching only one inning in the big leagues. It's kind of an honor to know that they're, you know, people out there still care. To talk to people, yeah, they do remember the Seattle Pilots.
You get people that send you letters and asking for autographs, and most of them, it's about Seattle. I remember, well, they remember better than I do, but, you know, it's nice to be part of an organization that is remembered that way, even if it is for 1 year. If they can think back and say that, you know, I remember seeing you play in Seattle or whatever it was, or if it was Minnesota, and they're asking for autographs, God bless them. That's wonderful.
Well, you know, I think basically because it was just a 1 year, you know. I mean, even though the franchise moved to Milwaukee, it was, and then I think Boughton's book, Ball Four, I think, you know, came in and got some interest to the fans, and it kind of put it in the spotlight. Of the my autographs, I don't get a ton of autographs, but I get, you know, 2 or 3 fans, you know, sending cards to sign, and Seattle Pilots is the big card. You know, that's the collector's card.
1 year, you know, we're talking about a major league franchise. I mean, when you think of a franchise, you think of 100 years. You think of the Boston Red Sox, the Chicago Cubs, the New York Yankees. In 1 year, a big league, and that happens, that doesn't even happen in the minor leagues. I mean, you don't get a franchise in the minor leagues and you see it gone the next year.
I suppose to the same popularity of a misprinted stamp or a misstamped coin, you know, the utter freakiness of the Pilots, a 1 year team. And there was so much goofiness that Boughton immortalized that the team and its image, just the idea of a 1 year team, became endearing.
Go, go, you Pilots, you proud Seattle team. Go, go, you Pilots, go out and build a dream.
So welcome to Seattle. Man, it's gonna be a gas. Go, 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 go.
You know, I've heard some conspiracy theories about why the pilots left, but I think really it was kind of a perfect storm of things that happened, starting with financial mismanagement. You know, most of the money that financed the pilots was borrowed money. And so, of course, when you borrow money, you have to pay it back with interest. And so they had a pretty heavy debt load to begin with. They also, the management was thinking that the game would promote itself and that they didn't really need to get out there and sell as much. The TV contract, there was no TV contract pilots. I think there was only one game that was ever televised in the Seattle area. I know, it's amazing. When you think about it now, you know, every game is on TV, but there was one game that was ever on. The relationship with the city. So Sick's Stadium, of course, was the minor league ballpark that was remodeled for Major League Baseball. And the city had made a lot of promises as a condition of the city getting a franchise that were not followed. You know, on opening day, they were still, literally, they were still nailing down planks for benches. And once they finished in their section, they let more people in. I mean, it was really that bad. They were way behind schedule. It wasn't anything like they had promised. The mayor at the time was a guy named Floyd Miller, who'd taken over when Dorm Brayman went back east to help with the administration. And he played hardball with them. You know, he actually threatened to evict the team unless they paid the rent that was past due. So yeah, kind of a bad situation there. Dewey and Max Soriano, you know, I've heard them vilified, and of course they were burned in effigy under the monorail when the pilots left town, but I really don't think it was their fault, but they were not as well connected within the business community as we might have seen, and so any help that might have been forthcoming in helping keep the pilots here was not forthcoming. And then the banks. So when it looked like the team was not doing well, the Bank of California was the main lender, and they said, okay, if somebody wants to buy the team, you have to pay us back in full. We're not carrying the loan anymore. So, you know, we're talking about $4 million, which in 1969 is some pretty serious money. I wouldn't mind having it now. But so they couldn't find the money to finance it. And in fact, when You'll see some of, Charles has some of the news clippings back there when Fred Danz from Sterling Recreation Organization tried to buy the team, and the reason that fell through was that the banks would not carry the loan. So he had to come up with an additional $4 million. And that was why when Eddie Carlson was going to buy the team and run it as a nonprofit, that's why he structured it that way, because the money was not forthcoming. So I had a chance to interview Dewey and Max Soriano before Dewey died. Max is still alive. And I asked Max, when did you know that there were problems? And he said, you know, in early May, we had a series against the Red Sox. And, of course, Carl Yastrzemski came out to push for the Dome Stadium initiative. And he said the weather was perfect. You know, all the great players on the Red Sox, and there was about 7,000 people in the stadium. And he said, I just had a feeling then that we were going to be in trouble. And then he said in July, he looked at this, which is the projection of cash flow. And he said, I realized that we were going to be short about $2.2 million in operations, and we were not going to be able to have the kind of money to make it through the off season without the ticket revenue coming in. So I said, but you know, Max, I read this thing, and of the $2.2 million, all but about $250,000 is depreciation of player contracts for tax purposes. That's not actually money that you lost. And he said, that's true, but Dewey and I didn't have $250,000. And so where was the money going to come from? So Bill Daly, who was a former owner of the Cleveland Indians and was the money guy behind the Pilots, declined to put in more money. And in fact, he kind of had he issued an edict that the fans had one more year to come. Otherwise, that was it for the Pilots. And that did not play well. And of course, Hi Zimmerman from the Times wrote a column entitled, Bill Daly, Won't You Please Go Home? And that didn't sit well with him either. And so for whatever reason, I mean, he was sort of an elderly gentleman at the time, had been around baseball for a long time, probably thought that this was going to be, this operation was going to go full steam pretty quickly. And when it didn't, he probably got frustrated. But for whatever reason, and this is one of the great mysteries, and he died in 1971, so I never had a chance to interview him, why he decided not to put more money into the team. And that's just something we'll never know. But he was the guy who really could have kept the team here. A couple of myths, you know, people have talked about Pilots attendance being low, and it was low. It was about 677,000, but it wasn't the lowest. I mean, I think it was the fifth or sixth lowest in the American League that year. And in fact, the Padres, who were the Pilots expansion brethren, didn't match the Pilots attendance until 5 years after they had been in the league. And that wasn't until they got bought by McDonald's founder, Ray Kroc. And the condition of Sick Stadium, you know, granted, not a major league quality ballpark. A lot of problems with the toilets not flushing in the late innings, and a lot of things that have been chronicled in many places. But you know, I had a chance to interview Bill Dwyer, who later went on to become a federal judge, but at the time was the lawyer who sued the American League on behalf of the state, the city, and the county. And he said, you know, we sent photographers around to the, you know, maybe some of you guys could, because you actually played in some of these other stadiums. He said, we sent some photographers around to some of the other American League ballparks. And he said, I got to tell you, there were not a lot of winners there. He said, we saw a lot of the same problems that we saw in Sick Stadium in some of the other ballparks. So that's just kind of the high-level view of why the Pilots left town. But again, I can't tell you how thrilled I am that the guys are back here today and that you guys are all here today. And I hope you're going to support the film when it comes out. Thanks, Steve. Thank you, Charles. Oh, and one more thing I forgot to tell you. Charles was mentioning the when you went with Jim to Lowe's. And it was really funny because if you go down there, I think they still have, like a metal cutout, a silhouette of a batter, and he's facing the wrong way. Right. Which I don't know, maybe that was emblematic. I don't know. And they actually used to have a display there of memorabilia, and I'll never forget they had a picture of Don Mincher, and the caption was, Don Mercher, Pilots pitcher. From 1970. Pitcher was in 1970. So thank you so much. I hope you visit SeattlePilots.com and give these guys a big hand. Thank you.
this is a once-in-a-lifetime event. The Seattle Pilots are the only one-year major league team in modern baseball history, and today is the first and perhaps the only reunion in the Seattle area. I was 13 in 1969, and I could hardly contain my excitement. After following the Seattle Rainiers and the Seattle Angels, I'd finally get to root for a major league team in Sick Stadium. For many baseball fans, it was a time of intense pride and fulfillment. We'd finally made it. The players and the fans questioned, I'm sure, the quality of the ballpark, the high ticket prices, some of the transactions that Marvin Milks made. But there was a special bond that the players and the fans shared together. Today, we have the opportunity to reminisce about the 1969 Pilots. We recall with enthusiasm all the players, whether they appeared in only one game, or had only 10 at-bats, or became known better, perhaps, as a writer than a knuckleball pitcher, or went to school with Lenny Wilkins. These boys of summer, many of them now grandfathers, they will always be our boys of summer. They are connectors of baseball fans from one generation to another. I suppose my reason for collecting baseball memorabilia is that it helps keep these memories in front of my mental archive. There's a story behind many of the items that I have, and perhaps this keeps me young. If you get a chance to take a look at the display, and I hope you will, some of the unusual pieces that I have in there are a Seattle Pilots hairnet case, because you know, it rained a lot. It was windy a lot. But that's the only one I've ever seen, and that was intended to be a 1970 promotional item. There's a Seattle Pilots pen in the shape of a cigar. I've only seen that one. I haven't seen any others. I think it was a sample that they turned down. And then there's a sample general admission ticket. It's stamped sample, and it's ticket number 000000. Some of the favorite pieces that I have here today are a Pilot's batting helmet, not the giveaway ones, but the ones that the players used. An old Woody card. How many of you did the old Woody contest or remember what that was? They'd bring a wood frame to home plate at the Seattle Elementary Schools, and you'd get a card every year. The card had a picture of the Seattle manager, so depending on who the manager was that year, those pictures changed. The one that's here is from 1969, of course, with Joe Schultz. And then it had 1 through 27 around the borders, the idea being perhaps you could pitch a hypothetical perfect game. If you got 3 balls through the wooden frame before you had 4 balls, then you would have struck out the imaginary batter and you got to pitch to the next one. So you have to go over there and see how I did. And then finally, this usher's jacket, which my friend Stuart said probably would fit in well at a jester's funeral. I've also got a case that has some other Seattle baseball history items before the Pilots. There's an uncut sheet of Seattle Rainiers popcorn cards. Those were issued in the popcorn boxes, the rectangular ones and the megaphones also. And I'm still avidly collecting those today. And then I have a number of items pre-Seattle Rainiers that are in that case. Most often the team was known as the Seattle Indians during those days. So I hope you get a chance to see the memorabilia and enjoy it as much as I enjoy it. I want to thank all the players who traveled here today, Steve Cox and Brad Powers, for this phenomenal event and undertaking. We all look forward to the documentary. And to Mike Fuller for keeping the Pilots alive on the web. I hope you've checked out his website. He'll be speaking in a moment. I want to thank Art Thiel for his writing and talking about Seattle baseball history. And then one other special thank you. Jim, it's been my pleasure to help you with the last edition of Ball for the Final Pitch. Jim Boughton was out here several years ago on a book tour, and I had the privilege of going around with him to some of his signings. And one day, in between signings, we decided to take a trip. We drove down to Rainier and McClellan. And of course, this is where the old ballpark was. We didn't have any illusions that we were going to see Sick Stadium there. We saw Lowe's Hardware instead. But Jim walked in, and he was on a mission. I said, "What are you doing?" He says, "I'm going to find where the pitching rubber was." So he walked around, and there was this paint slab on the floor there. And he said, "This is where the pitching rubber was." And he stood on it. And for a minute, we were in Sick Stadium. And he said, "I can see home plate. I can see Mount Rainier over right field. I can see the dugouts. And I can see the left field wall. And I can see Joe Schultz looking at me after I sent another ball over that left field wall." So thank you, everybody. And on with the show.
Well, I think most of us read it, and obviously a little bit in self-defense to make sure we weren't going to be the Mickey Mantle. But I don't think, well, there might have been some of us that said, "No, I don't want to go anywhere near it." But certainly it's an exposure that was going to happen. It was most of it, as we even gathered around and said. It may have been a little bit different in its time, but unfortunately, Jim never got sued because most of it was true.
One other thing. You know, like you said, it said some derogatory things about certain people. And for some reason, he said some nice things about me. I didn't know why, because the next year I went, Schultz was in spring training, and I walked towards him to say hello, and he said, "Don't come here, Jim Boughton, Bobo."
You know, it was just an opportunity to get to play. I was in Baltimore, and when you look at where most guys were drafted, some guys were a high draft pick by Seattle, some guys were in the middle of the pack. But on every club, you were the 15th guy on their roster that they didn't protect. So to get that opportunity to come to either Seattle or Kansas City or whatever it was, just to get an opportunity to play. And like you said, some guys were at the end of the career, it was a restart for them. But for me, it was an opportunity to play. They found out pretty early that I couldn't because they traded me in June.
Seattle Pilots was the major leagues, and that's all you strived to do was be in the major leagues. I would have been happy to play my whole career here.
You did?
Yeah, I did.
I'm not going to say it. Goose could hit. He could hit, really.
Well, I wasn't in the expansion draft, but was going very poorly for the Chicago White Sox. And after 2 months, they decided I was done. And it was kind of ironic to me because I had one pitch, was a sinking fastball, and was very temperamental, and I lost it. And I found it. Just before they traded me, I walked three hitters, which I never, that was a cardinal sin, and I knew I had it. And I came back into the dugout, and they were ready to write me off, and I said, "That's the best game I've had. I've got it." And a week later, I was gone. However, I think I had my sinker back, and my career was resurrected, and they traded me eventually. I got traded to the Oakland A's, and thanks to that little move probably led to a couple of World Series rings. So thank you, Seattle.
I was the one that was traded for Lou Piniella. So one red asked for another. I guess that's what they tell him. But that's really what happened, because when I was drafted by Kansas City, a lot of these guys might remember, we had a little mini strike going in spring training. And I only had a couple years under my belt at the time, but Mo Drabowski, who was our proxy, our pl- player rep by proxy got a hold of me after the draft and said, you know, don't report to spring training. We got a little problem here. We're trying to, the union, we got to stand strong in the union. So I'm hanging out in Hollywood, Florida with my fiance at the time, and all of a sudden I turn on the TV after, you know, everybody reports to, there's 60 ball players report to Fort Myers for Kansas City, and only four of us didn't. Joe Foy, Mo Drabowski, myself, and I think Fitzpatrick. So when I finally report about 10 days later, Cedric Tallis, he was totally pissed, and he just said, you know, why didn't you, you know, what was you thinking? You should have been the first one here, which I should have, because I was AWOL with the 1968 Yankees, too. So this was my whole career was just in a spiral. But I did not report, trying to be a union guy, and when I finally... then I got traded 10 days later to Seattle for Pinella. And when I arrived in Tempe, Milks picked me up personally in the airport, and he said, you know, this is about a five-minute drive to Tempe, to the hotel, but it's a quick drive right back if you pull any of that stuff with us. And so I was on, and so I had to have a great spring training, which I did, to even make the club up north. So we're all grateful. I mean, it was a second chance. For us to participate. Plus, I'm a hometown. I'm from Tacoma, so I was coming back home. So it was good for me.
Yeah. I know myself. I got traded from Baltimore along with Gene Brabrander, and it was of course I went to AAA, and it gave you the thought and hope that someday you might get a chance to play for the Pilots. And lo and behold, every shortstop that played for the Pilots that year got hurt. So they were looking for anybody that could catch the ball, and that's one thing at least I could do. I wasn't going to hit it very well, but it did give me an opportunity to get the big leagues for a while.
Got traded over from the Cleveland Indians to the Seattle Pilots, and went to Vancouver, AAA ball for about 2 months. And when I got the call that I was coming here, and the guy asked me the other day, he said, how'd you feel about that? I had no feeling. I was happy as hell to get out of there, to get down here. And it started my career, and I love this city, Seattle Pilots.
Yeah, I really think it was out of our control, and we weren't privy to what was going on, and it was the case of we just had to report and be ready, and I think we were all just trying to get through spring training and do the best we can to be ready, and that was kind of the case of having you didn't know where the bus was headed, but we were soon going to leave spring training and go somewhere. And yeah, I think I've been traded several times, and I think that's the case of many of the players up here. And never was I traded that I wasn't very disappointed, but never did it work out to where it wasn't actually something that furthered a career. So Milwaukee wasn't a very good stop for me because the manager there, I don't think, was a big fan. And I was sold to Oakland within 2 weeks after the family just got there a couple of days before. So by the end of April, I think it was, I was traded to the Oakland A's, or sold, or whatever, and there are those two World Series rings. So, Mac and I loved the area because we both loved to fish, and I shouldn't tell this, but it is true. Mac had a pickup truck, and we bought a mattress and put it in the back, and I was the relief pitcher, so I didn't have to pitch early, and we would drive south the whole length of the state, go into, I don't know whether it was Southern Washington or Upper Oregon, the steelhead fish, the Tootle, the Green, all the rivers down there. We'd leave after the ball game, 10:30 at night, get something to eat in the clubhouse, drive all night, get there at 5 in the morning, get out and fish. But the trick was whoever had to play the next night, and it was usually Mac, would get to sleep on the way home. So Mac would drive down, I'd drive back, and we got back after a whole day of me catching two and Mac zero. But we loved it. I mean, it's a beautiful country, and I was traded in June, so what weather? I mean, I saw nothing but spectacular weather, loved the city, and I didn't want to go anywhere, but we had no choice.
I've been coming to Seattle for a long time. I was in the Pacific Coast League, and we used to come in here and play. And where we went after the ball game, I can't say because my wife is sitting right over there. So I'm going to take the fifth on that one.
My wife and I lived out in Bellevue here, in fact. And I think just to be able to go to the ballpark every day and drive across the lake and look at the mountains, and we both loved it up here, but I got traded to Oakland in June, so that kind of was a turnaround for me. And like Bob Locker said, a couple of World Series rings later, you know, it was that made the difference. But I love the area. I love the mountains up here. And as far as I can remember, I don't think we ever got rained out for the first 2 or 3 months of the season up here. The weather wasn't like it was today. I mean, it was gorgeous. It was who was it that wrote the song? The bluest skies are in Seattle. And it was for us that year.